Today I want to talk to you about some of the sound signs of deception. We've looked at nonverbal and verbal cues, both of which are not as diagnostic as I think some of the other things are that we're talking about this week. The three patterns that I've talked about in my lecture are signs of tension, signs of cognitive load, and signs of uncertainty. And I think those three things are better ways to detect deception than just trying to pick up on subtle cues. We also are going to look at a way that we can manipulate cognitive load by asking the reverse order question. Three things I want you to remember about these videos. One is that they're actors, so they're very well polished, and they're probably good liars because they're good at improvising. The second is that these are sanctioned lies, which means I asked them to lie, but they're also unscripted. They didn't know what questions were coming. And the third thing is that these are really just conversations, not interrogations. So you shouldn't take them as signs that you might see in an interrogation, just more general conversational deception. Okay, let's look at the first liar.
So Zach, it's really great to have you here today. I'm glad you could join us. We're gonna go ahead and just have a very casual conversation. We're just gonna ask you an assortment of questions and just have you respond. So first off, we're just gonna jump right in. What is the worst job you've ever had and why did you dislike it?
So some of the things that we've already mentioned are the tension that you can see in his body. He sits very still, he sits very upright, he doesn't move his head very much, he doesn't gesture at all, he keeps his hands locked together in his lap. So those are all signs that he might be a little bit tense while he's talking. He also shows some signs of cognitive load, a lot of filled pauses, which we said were pauses that were filled with things like ums and uhs. But he doesn't give a lot of those, and so it's not maybe the best diagnostic cue for him. He also does give some signs of uncertainty. I'll show you an example.
What would you do if your boss gave you credit for someone else's work?
If my boss gave me credit for someone else's work, I might just let it be. I mean, if I'm getting credit for someone else's work, maybe it'll help me grow to a place I need to be.
So we already talked about some of these signs of uncertainty. He says, maybe. He says, I might just let it be. He also seems kind of uncertain in his vocal inflection. The vocal pitch goes up at the end of his sentences. And so he almost sounds like he's asking questions instead of making statements. I also want to show you his answer to the reverse order question. Reverse order questions are a common interrogation technique where you can ask somebody to describe something temporally, but do it backwards because that's much more cognitively difficult. When you increase the cognitive load, they're more likely to show signs of deception because they have to recreate something that didn't really happen and do it also in reverse order. It's a very cognitively difficult thing to do. I've noticed in watching these videos, we have five actors and they all approached it in a little bit different way. Some of them were very specific. They gave minute details. I shaved, I brushed my teeth. But others of them just said, I got dressed or I got ready. They were more vague. So I think that when you're more detailed, it makes it more difficult because then you have to keep supplying that level of detail once you get into there. And that kind of tripped up some of our deceivers. But the ones who are a little bit more vague, they sailed through that question with a little bit more ease, and they had an easier time trying to recreate their day when they didn't feel like they had to give as much detail. I'll give you a couple of examples.
Please tell me everything you did today working backwards from when you arrived here to the moment you woke up.
Working backwards?
Yes.
Well, I arrived here to do this interview with you. Before that, I had McDonald's on the way, a sausage burrito. Before that, I took a shower. Before that, I shaved. And before that, I was definitely awake at around 6 a.m. just surfing the internet.
On the dot, 6 o'clock.
I would say close to 6 o'clock, yeah.
Okay.
Okay, a couple things to know about this. He gives some level of detail. He says he ate a sausage burrito, which is very specific, also a lie, by the way. But he also is kind of skipping over some things and ignoring some important factors. Like he didn't say how he got there or what he got dressed wearing or any of the kind of missing details in between shaving and eating a sausage burrito. He also says, I definitely got up at 6 a.m. And he's adding that extra level of certainty to try and counteract the fact that he might not be certain about that detail. When he gets pressed on it, he backs off on his certainty. He gets asked 6 o'clock on the dot, and he says, well, it was around 6 o'clock. In fact, he told us later that he slept in and he wasn't awake anywhere near 6 a.m. So his level of certainty at the beginning was kind of a ruse, and as soon as he got pressed on it a little bit, he backed off from that level of certainty. All might be together signs of deception. Any one of these details probably wouldn't be enough to call him a liar or prove that it wasn't true, but when you add up a lot of the details, the tension he's showing in his body, the ums and ahs he's showing as part of the cognitive load, the uncertainty that he expresses on several of his answers, and also the fact that he's skipping a lot of detail and showing extra certainty on certain details, and then a lot of missing activities in his reverse order account of his day, all those things add up to the sign that maybe he's not telling the truth. So here's Casey's reverse order question.
Please tell me everything you did working backwards from when you arrived here to the moment you woke up.
Working backwards. I came in and had a clementine here and a cup of coffee. And then I got in my car, turned the heater on. I guess I got out of my car.
Yeah, now this one's a little bit difficult.
Then I turned my car off.
Okay.
Is this too detailed?
No, this is perfect. Keep on going.
And then I turned the radio down, got in my car, left the heater off.
Wow, these are finite details. Keep on going.
And then I woke up.
Perfect.
So unlike Zach, who gave a few details like the sausage burrito and then skipped a lot of parts, she's adding those details in. She ate a clementine. She turned the radio down. But now she's kind of stuck giving that level of detail, and she's having difficulty with it because now she has to not only think about what a normal person would expect her to do in those particular backwards order, but she also is trying to fill in details that don't really exist. You can tell it's cognitively difficult for her. She's having a hard time with that question, and so those are indicators that she might be lying. This is liar number 3 again, and we're going to look for some of his signs of deception: uncertainty, cognitive load, and tension. He's being asked the reverse order question right now. It's a cognitively difficult question, but he buys himself some more time by having the question repeated.
Please tell me everything you did today, working backwards from the moment you arrived here to the moment you woke up.
Okay.
Tell me everything you did today, working backwards from this moment right now to when you woke up.
Okay. I walked into the building.
Again, the upward inflection, he doesn't sound certain about that at all.
I probably ate about 2 bagels, and then I literally woke up, I guess about 10 minutes before I had, like, actually, I was pretty late. And I didn't take a shower. I didn't even brush my teeth or anything like that.
Okay.
You notice some things in here that we call stutter starts, where he starts a sentence, stops the sentence, and then restarts it because he doesn't really like where it's going. So a lot of false starts in his sentences, and that might be a sign that he's trying to think up the right way to say it. Notice that the interviewer jumps in to rescue him. According to Dr. Burgoon's interpersonal deception theory, deception is actually a two-way street. The liar's lying, but the person asking the questions is actually helping with the lie. So the interviewer's trying to help him say something that would be more plausible. He says, oh, you weren't dilly-dallying, because he's seeing that The person is having a hard time coming up with all the answers. He's trying to explain what he was doing. I didn't really get ready. I didn't really shave. He's trying to say, I woke up right before I needed to leave. None of that's true, and so he's trying to find a plausible way to say it. The interviewer's help can actually make them sound more credible, because if the interviewer's trying to rescue this person and make them say something a little bit more clearly, then they can kind of grab onto that, and it gives them some sort of plausibility when they're giving their answers. So watch for that. When you're trying to detect deception, try not to jump in and finish the other person's sentences for them, because that's something that the liar can use to make their story more credible. This is liar number 5. He gets asked, what are your greatest strengths? And his answer is that he's very punctual. He actually says this as a joke because he knows the other actors in the room will find that funny. He's not very punctual, and he's certainly not known for his punctuality.
I'm very punctual. I think maybe...
Now, is this something that you feel confident that other people would say about you as well?
Yes. Yeah, I think so, yeah. Yeah, probably punctuality, and then like maybe...
So he gets asked, is this what other people would say about you too? And he says, yeah, I think so. So he shows a little bit of uncertainty there with his answer. He doesn't claim it. He doesn't say, absolutely, I'm punctual. He says, yeah, I think so. So a little bit of uncertainty in there. Again, he was very difficult for people to detect. He didn't give a lot of signs of tension. He doesn't really show a lot of cognitive load because he seems to answer very naturally. I would say of our 5 liars, he's the most difficult to detect. What I want you to remember about these different cues to deception is that rather than focusing on individual nonverbal or verbal cues, listening for particular things like eye gaze or fidgeting of the hands or vocal inflection, instead look at the whole package. Try and look at the overall tension that the person is showing, or maybe the signs of cognitive load, that they're having to think very hard about their answers, or that they can't give much detail to their answers as they're coming up with things on the fly. So those are maybe good signs of deception, but they might be expressed in different ways from different liars. So different people might tackle the reverse order question in different ways, some very detailed, some not detailed at all. And so I want you to think about the overall patterns rather than individual cues, because I think that will make you better at detecting deception.